bigger isn't always better.
Yeah.
Every year, the Brick Train Awards bring out the best and brightest in the hobby, who exhibit the finest models they've made over the last couple of years. In years past, I have turned to prototypes from the Nickel Plate Road, but for 2023, it was time to change things up. Submitted for Best Steam Locomotive, this is Wabash 534. The prototype was rolled out by Alco's Rhode Island Works in August of 1906 as the ninth of a 40 locomotive order. The 060s were designated as the B7 class by the Wabash, and 534 worked switching passenger cars around the railroad at various stations. We at least know it was in Decatur, Illinois in 1940, but after World War II, it worked at the Grand Street Station in and also around Fort Wayne, Indiana. But across America, diesels were spreading and displacing steam locomotives. Switchers were often the first to go on many railroads, and 534 was no exception. In 1952, it was transferred to Lake Erie and Fort Wayne, a small industrial railroad that moved steel for local manufacturers. Now, when I say small, the railroad comprised entirely of three employees, all brothers. One brother, the fireman, named the locomotive Nancy. Meanwhile, on the Wabash, the railroad dieselized by the end of 1953, except for a holdout of moguls on the Keokuk branch in Illinois due to weight restriction on the bridges of the branch line. One of those, 573, was preserved in St. Louis in 1955. For 2 years, Nancy became the only operational Wabash locomotive, finally being retired in March of 1957 to a display in Swinney Park. In 1984, the locomotive and caboose 2543 were donated to the Fort Wayne Railroad Historical Society. Since then, the locomotive has received stabilization work and is undergoing a slow restoration to once again operate in Indiana. The primary catalyst for designing a model of Wabash 534 started off as an idea for a tech demo in February of 2022. I was curious to see how well a representation of inside valve gear could be pulled off. Don't worry, I'll explain how that works later on in this video. The initial idea was to implement this on a model of Detroit Edison 202, but after researching a more obscure industrial switcher, it led to nothing but dead ends. As for the valve gear, the initial test proved that it was possible, but the idea sat on the shelf for a while. In November, Glenn Holland had begun assembly of his stunning Nickel Plate Road S2 Burke, and this lit my fire to start work on 765 Stablemate. I found B7 diagrams courtesy of the Norfolk and Western Historical and Technical Society, and the process of scaling began. Since a preserved locomotive is not fully assembled, I had to rely on low-resolution images, it became apparent that the brass model was a generic amalgamation of the B7 class, and they did sport some differences throughout their careers. Overall, the digital process of the design took about 3 months of off-and-on work. In the month of September, the parts were ordered and everything came together in a very painstaking build to ensure that 534 looked and performed well. It was time to debut it. In taking a look at the result, it's not a very big locomotive, but it's laced with detail. Both the engine and tender each have three key features that make the model stand out. And I want to start with the tender. 534's tender presented a few unique challenges. The first was the slope-back style tender that is commonly seen on steam locomotives geared for switching. Since locomotives like these would always be near a water tower or standpipe in a yard, the slope-back tender was a compromise to provide better visibility to the engineer in lieu of more stored water. An easy solution to modeling this would be using slope bricks. That doesn't quite create a clean line going down the tender. Now, to get that clean line, I used an intricate process of offsetting cheese slopes to get the desired effect, cleanly running into a curved slope brick. Since the tender is not tall enough to pack in a battery box to power the motor, the inside is hollow and large enough to eventually implement the Bluenami DCC sound system into the locomotive. For this video, the motor wire is running into the tender to show the connection. The second key detail is the ever so subtle frame, which has the proper coupler cut bar, footboards, and the main beams that sit offset from the bottom of the tender at 7 studs wide. This comes at the expense of running the engine on tight curves, and as of right now, it's really only able to handle the R104 switches and curves. The huge standout feature of the tender is its raised coal bunker, which is unusual for having a wedge shape. Pulling off the contoured design took a while to design on the computer, and I was concerned that the solution I came up with would be flimsy. Surprisingly, the design is quite strong and stays in place extremely well and exactly how it needs to. There's plenty of other little details like the headlight and the panels on the fireman's side to round it out, but let's move on to the locomotive. The first key area I want to highlight is 534's wheelbase and valve gear. These are extremely unique in LEGO form. The middle blind driver is offset by a half a stud to sit closer to the rear driver, allowing for a bigger gap between the middle and front driver, just like the prototype. This is to allow for the eccentric return to sit inside the frame, a common feature on older locomotives that have internal Stevenson or Walshart's valve gear. Now, on a steam locomotive like Nickel Plate Road 765, all of the valve gear sits on the outside of the wheels for easier access to oiling, maintenance, and other lubrication. Inside the frame, I use trained brick rods and Technic pieces to simulate the inside crank. This gives the return valve that little rocking motion that is the key feature of the design. It's a blink and you miss it detail, but the movement of the slide valve is overlooked on so many models across several gauges. This gimmick allows for a true open frame with actual motion moving in between. The only drawback to the design is that it does not reflect true Stevenson valve gear and looks more like internal Walshart's. But in the space required, with the amount of 3D printed parts interacting with each other, it would not be practical or even possible to pull it off. Regardless, most people won't notice it, but if you know where to look, it's there and it works. Right above the frame, the locomotive's boiler and firebox presented a few pain points. For starters, the boiler diameter is too small to house a power functions type motor. Rather than cheat the dimensions to pack one in, I turned to the firebox. The firebox is long and shallow, butting up against the rear of the cab to create a deckless engine, like Norfolk and Western 475. It was tight, but I was able to vertically mount a medium-sized power function motor and hold it in by Technic clips to power the rear drivers. The third key feature, or features, of the locomotive are the little things that round it out. Now, when dealing with the finite size of LEGO bricks and flex hoses, certain details may be omitted while others are there. 534's motor mount meant that the prototypical gap between the frame and the boiler was left wide open to be worked on, and I took full advantage of it. On the engineer's side alone, we have the Alco power reverse, air tank, and toolbox. The flex hose pipework reflects the injector and feed water heater. Oh, did I mention the leaf springs as well? The fireman's side is the same injector arrangement with the air pump sitting nicely into the running board. The drop from two studs wide to one stud on the running board is correct for the prototype. The dynamo, whistle, bell placement, and domes are all correct for the top of the boiler, and really the only detail I chose to omit were the sand lines. If I had done them, they would have used thread, and it would have been overkill. But as it is, the end result is amazing. All things considered, this was the first serious attempt at a steam locomotive from the ground up, and it's extremely rewarding to see it sitting before me. I was hesitant to enter something in the best steam locomotive category, because I knew that if I did, that entry would have to push the envelope of what is possible in L gauge. Wabash 534 took from the best design techniques to create a realistic steam locomotive and tender, with dimensions and features that are simply daunting to try in LEGO. Sure, it doesn't have the Blue Nami decoder yet, but that should not detract from the physical model. I owe a sincere thank you to Glenn Holland for designing the rods and printing the headlight covers while listening to me ramble on about the design process while I sounded out ideas. I also want to give a thank you to the Big Fab Lab in Bowling Green. They helped make the stickers on this locomotive a reality. There are many excellent builders in the L-Gauge community whose creativity has pushed this quirky little gauge into the realms of serious model railroading. And I want to thank them for continuing to inspire other builders. The Brick Train Awards bring out the best of the best in this hobby. And Wabash 534 is my small crown jewel I offer up to the judges. Hope you like it. Thanks for watching.